Native people, Native culture, Native knowledge. Hi, I'm Jeannie Green, bringing you award-winning Heartbeat Alaska.
Bringing you national and international Native news, this is award-winning Heartbeat Alaska, the premier Native voice in Native programming.
There's a heartbeat louder than thunder. Revolution is in the air. There's a heartbeat deep inside our mother. Are you too cool to care?
Now, with Heartbeat Alaska, here's Jeannie Green.
Hello, welcome to Heartbeat Alaska, Native news and Native entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green. Thank you so much for joining us.
Today we travel on down to Southeast Alaska, to Angoon. And then we learn how to make fry bread with music by Indian artist Jen Hewitt.
And on down to Seward, Alaska for their Qutekcak annual sobriety powwow. We have Native American, Canadian Native music videos
and much more. Get ready for some delicious fry bread right after this. Heartbeat Alaska thanks our sponsors. Thank you for making this program possible. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Alaska, providing quality health care service to Alaskans since 1957. And Chugach Alaska Corporation. Thank you so much, Chugach Alaska Corporation. And also, Coca-Cola. Thank you, Coca-Cola, for coming on board and sponsoring Heartbeat Alaska. You've been serving Alaskans since 1937, and we thank you.
They are high government officials. The head of the Navajo Nation is battling back after the tribal newspaper published accounts of marital infidelity and misuse of tribal funds. President Albert Hale has been accused of carrying on an affair with his press secretary and of spending several thousand dollars in tribal funds. That accusation came from his ex-wife, Regina Pinto Hale. In a recent press release, Hale says his former wife has lied and that he had no chance to reply to the charges published in the Navajo Times. How about building a National Hall of Fame for Native rodeo stars? That's the idea being developed by Native rodeo fans at the Oglala Nation Rodeo Committee, according to Indian Country Today. The group feels there have been enough great Native rodeo stars to build such a hall. They plan to contact other tribes for their support for the plan. We'll be back with more Native news across the nation right after this.
Contact Heartbeat Alaska with your news. Heartbeat Alaska, 5861 Arctic Boulevard, Unit B, Anchorage, Alaska, 99518. That's Heartbeat Alaska, 5861 Arctic Boulevard, Unit B, Anchorage, Alaska, 99518. Or give us a call at 1-907-563-7440 or fax us at 1-907-563-9309. Heartbeat Alaska, your news is our news.
On Capitol Hill, a bill to implement recommendations to aid Alaska Natives has passed the U.S. House of Representatives. In the last few years, an Alaska Native Commission has made a comprehensive study of the status of the state's Native peoples. It found dismal conditions and predicted a dark future if outside help were not implemented to aid their economic, health, and cultural futures. The Yakima Nation of Washington is set to levy tribal taxes on income, vehicles, tobacco, and a host of other things as a revenue maker, but the tax idea doesn't set too well with their neighbors. Local landowners, residents, and the cities of Wapato and Toppenish are taking their case to Washington Senator Slade Gordon. They say it's taxation without representation, and they want the senator to help kill the plan. But the tribe says the opposition is premature since the plan is only a draft. In California, the Sikyuan Indian band has dropped its ties with a minority-run college there, DQ University. The tribe says it wants its tribal members to be able to use their tribal scholarships at any college that they choose to attend. DQ University officials say the tribe dropped the ties without giving them any notice or indications that there was a problem. And finally, an Oregon tribe has instituted mandatory drug tests for its tribal workers. A report from the Confederated Umatilla Journal says tribal workers can now randomly be tested for the presence of drugs in their system. Umatilla officials say the new drug policy provides an option for workers found to be using illegal substances to attend drug treatment or, as a last resort, termination. And we'd like to thank our viewers who have been sending in their news. It really makes a difference for us. This is Native News Across the Nation. I'm Gary Fife, and back to Jeannie Green and more Heartbeat Alaska.
Thank you, Gary. Some villages in Alaska are located on water-soaked tundra. Tuntutuliaj, Alaska, the Yupik village in southwestern Alaska, is one of those villages. How do they deal with it? By using boardwalks. And this year, they got a brand new one. Tuntutuliaj is located on a broad, flat floodplain near the mouth of the Kuskokwim River. The land has been described as floating tundra. In the past, the residents walked along an old boardwalk, which has been described as a mess, broken and shattered, causing many accidents over the years. A 4-mile-long, 10-foot-wide boardwalk was made possible and may possibly be the longest boardwalk in North America. 4 miles long, 10 feet wide, in the village of Tuntutuliaj, Alaska.
This is the Lewis Sangapak Memorial School.
The boardwalk was designed by state engineers and built by Yupik Eskimo crews. Long steel shafts, looking like giant screws, were put as deep as 50 feet into the ground.
The population of the village is approximately 350 people. The primary language of the village is Yupik, with English as a secondary language.
The new boardwalk will change the lives of the people of Tuntutuliaj. They'll be exposed to regulations we in urban areas are familiar with, speed signs. Though you won't be seeing drag races here, the boardwalk is kind of like a boardwalk highway. It can handle heavy equipment and rollerblades. Still, the change is overall a pleasant one for the people of Tuntutuliaj. Thank you so much, Kathy Buhach, Robert Enoch, Barbara Daniels, and all the students that worked on the project of Tuntutuliaj's new boardwalk for Heartbeat Alaska. Thank you so very much. We travel now to Rock Point, Arizona, and visit the Rock Point Navajo School.
To be Navajo begins the moment a child is born. And this way, a child learns the beauty way. Living the beauty way is living in Hujo, living in balance with the world. Many Navajo children lost Hujo when they were forced to go to boarding schools hundreds of miles away from their homes and families. At the government schools, Native American children were severely punished for practicing the beauty way or any other Native value system. Feeling lonely and confused, some Native American children ran away. Others committed suicide. Honoring young lives is the priority of educators at the Rock Point Community School on the Navajo Reservation. Resting on a high desert mesa in northeastern Arizona, the Rock Point School offers an educational curriculum based on Navajo values and philosophy.
For our people, there are five principles we live by. Something you live by every day, you have to go accordingly. You have to respect. Self-respect, everyone understands. And then try to live a good life.
The beauty way, the Navajo way of learning and living, is integrated into the cultural heritage classes at the Rock Point School. In the beauty way, instructors relate to their students in kinship terms. At an early age, Navajo children learn who their relatives are through an intricate clan system. Using the ke or clan system and other beauty ways at the Rock Point School complements and reinforces what parents teach their children at home. In addition to using kinship terms, in her sash belt making class, Jean Jones teaches her students the traditional history behind this sash belt. She tells them about changing woman, known to the Navajo people as the mother of the Navajo clans.
When she had her twins, she used a sash belt, put it around her waist after she had her baby, so she will not hurt, and she would give her strength. And they said that you wear a sash belt to put yourself in shape again after you have your baby. So you sit straight, and if you wear your sash belt, you would sit straight, keep your stomach in. This is how they used to wear it. So she was the first one to wear it.
In the Navajo way, the sash belt must be worn properly. This reinforces traditional teachings that everything has order and harmony.
Hold on to the two in the back. Then take another two from the other side. Then tie here.
The Navajo Oral Traditions class is taught by Ernest Harry Begay, a former councilman for the Navajo Nation.
Navajo Oral Traditions class, yeah. The net after two or the next either. That's your name, legend.
Navajo Oral Traditions covers religion, philosophy, and history of the Navajo people.
When you go see a medicine man, a stargazer, he has his crystal. You do not appear to him like the way that we are. How does he determine, the sex of the individual? Well, there are symbols. They go by symbols.
Following week, but I want you to start editing next week. So sign up for editing time during school. You can sign up for first hour. You can sign up for after class.
In the bilingual television production classes, Navajo students become expert editors, camera operators, producers, writers, and directors. These production skills allow Navajo students to produce culturally relevant programs in the Navajo language. The beauty way is also taught during the weaving, basket making, and silversmithing classes at the Rock Point Community School.
The Navajo oral traditions are very alive today, and I think it's because the elders have really seen and made the youngsters, the next generation, they have tried to preserve that information possible for them, and they made a lot of sacrifices for them.
In this way, education of Navajo students will return to Hujo, the beauty way of the Navajo.
Powerful forces shaped Alaska. Powerful forces are still shaping it today. The federal government has never given up its control of Alaska's lands and resources. It has taken Alaskans of strength and vision to help the 49th state emerge from a federal wilderness. It has been a constant battle to progress and protect and progress again. To keep Alaskan issues from being swept under the congressional carpet. Today, at a critical time in our continued battle with Washington, there is one leader who has carried Alaska's flag to the top of the hill again and again, Senator Ted Stevens. And he fights for us today with the greatest power Alaska has ever enjoyed. Look into Ted Stevens' eyes, and you see the same energy and fire that was there when he helped write our Statehood Act, because Ted has never lost sight of what he's fighting for, Alaska.
14 years ago, a group of Alaskans got together and decided to lower the cost of a long-distance phone call. They created GCI. Today, the vision is working. Since 1982, long-distance rates have dropped more than 50%. GCI is bringing that same vision to communities, both large and small, throughout Alaska. Lower rates and better connections. GCI Long Distance, bringing a change for the better.
Our future depends on what we do today. That's why I'm so proud of my dad, Congressman Don Young. He strengthened the 200-mile fishing limit, provided funding for water and sewer construction in rural and native villages, helped lift the ban on oil exports, and fought for our private property rights. As chairman of the House Resources Committee, Don Young has demonstrated that he cares about the future of Alaska and the children who are the future.
Don Young, standing up for Alaska.
From Rock Point, we're making tracks now to Seward, Alaska, for the annual Qutekcak Native Tribe Sobriety Powwow.
Thank you, Lord, for being with us today as we gather and celebrate our lives.
They gathered together for the fourth year in a row, the Qutekcak Native Tribe, based out of Seward, Alaska, the beautiful city at the head of Resurrection Bay. The gathering was held to celebrate with sobriety and also to honor women from the Qutekcak Native Corporation who have helped with tribal activities in the past years. The Qutekcak Native Corporation is very unique, with over 500 members of many different indigenous nations. The fourth annual powwow had many reasons to celebrate. One was the discovery of an ulu that was found on the beach of Seward in 1993 by Julie Moncrief. She donated it to Qutekcak Native Corporation.
Since 1993.
The discovery of the ulu proves that natives were the first inhabitants of the area now called Seward, Alaska.
Oh,
Native people, Native culture, Native knowledge. Hi, I'm Jeannie Green, bringing you award-winning Heartbeat Alaska, national and international Native news and entertainment, the premier Native voice in Native programming.
There's a heartbeat louder than thunder, revolution is in the air.
Before we move on, I have a missing person alert. Her name is Jalynn John. She was last seen in Tanacross, Alaska on September 11th. If you've seen Jalynn John, please contact the Alaska State Troopers at 883-5511 or the Tanacross Council at 883-5024 or Clifford Henry at 883-3096. Contact Heartbeat Alaska if you did not get those numbers. We take a moment now for some good Native American Canadian Native music. By the way, if you have a special video that you'd like to see again, call us here at Heartbeat Alaska.
We're all the same. Oh, Siem, we're all the same.
you once again for joining us for another Heartbeat Alaska, Native news and Native entertainment, the premier voice for Native information across America. We're so glad to have you with us this day. Thank you so much, Colleen Keene, for the video from Rock Point School out of Rock Point, Arizona. Thank you, everyone in Seward, for the Qutekcak Native Tribe Sobriety Powwow video. And also, all the very special people in Tuntutuliaj, Alaska. Hello to all of you from Heartbeat Alaska, and thank you for sending the video. God bless you. Have a fabulous week, and please tune in again for more Native news next week. I'm Jeannie Green. We'll see you then. There's a happy